is on equity and happiness in partnership with UNDP Pakistan. And we are obliged to have our panelists with us. And Mr. Amjad Saqib is here with us from Akhuwat. I wish if we can give them a big round of applause with each name. Amjad Saqib Saab, Ms. Iram, the law and policy expert, water law and policy expert, and then Hafiz Pasha Saab, the economist, and Taimur Jagra Saab, finance minister, Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. And this is going to be moderated by Neil from United Nations. Thank you very much, sir, for being with us. And Mike is over to you.
Thank you. I'm going to start like this. And why? Get your attention, and maybe if I ring it loud enough, maybe more people come in from the street than the door. But if I ring it loud enough, maybe we get some more people coming in as well. But this may seem a bit facetious, but one of the most influential books of the last 30 years was produced by a man from Lahore, Mahbub al Haq, working together with Amartya Sen. And if you look at the cover of the third Human Development Report from 1992, it's a glass that looks a little bit like this, but is more elongated, more like you might have an oyster or champagne in. And what does the glass represent? The glass represents actually income distribution in the world. So the bottom of the glass sort of represents the share of the 20% of the people in the world. Very, very small. The top of the glass, which is 150 times larger than the bottom of the glass, represented the share of the top 20% in the world. Now that was in 1992. Today it's probably a bit different. In fact, the latest statistic I had, that the world's richest 1%, those with more than $1 million, own 45% of the world's wealth. So in the Human Development Reports, going back to 90 and 92, one of the key facets is that economic growth does not automatically improve people's lives, either within nations, such as within Pakistan, or among nations internationally. In fact, if you look at and we discussed this actually in the populism session yesterday, and I think there's a couple of people who were there, about equity and development, that the two countries in the world which have made the most progress in the last 100 years in human development are the two which have had the most equitable income distribution. And those are, if you can't guess, it's Sweden and Japan. Now, we are fortunate to have a wonderful panel here. I had prepared very good introductions, but they've now been introduced by the MC. But to have Dr. Amjad Saqib, who is the leader of the world's largest interest-free microfinance program, it's a privilege to be on the same panel with him. To have Taimur Jangra, who is an engineer, had worked for McKinsey's, but is better known now as the Minister of Finance of the province of Khyber Pakhtunkhwa and a strong partner of the United Nations. We're fortunate to have Hafiz, who'll be talking next, who has been chairman of the Planning Commission. He's been Minister of Finance, and he also was my boss at one point for about a year and a half when he was director of UNDP's Regional Bureau for Asia Pacific and Assistant Secretary General, the first Pakistani to have had that job and the only to have had that job. And then on our left, Erum Khaled Sattar, who's a professor at Tufts and Northeastern University. She has a doctorate from Harvard, and on her dissertation committee was one of the co-founders of the Human Development Report, Dr. Amartya Sen. So we have about an hour. I should say that we're hoping that Dr. Shima Kermani will join the panel during the course of the discussion, and I think you know her as Pakistan's leading exponent of Bharatanatyam Jatiya, okay, I'm not pronouncing it right. And also, but more reason we had her on this panel is she's the founder of TEDIC in Niswan, which is one of the first women's movements dealing with the tremendous exclusion that so many women face. So why did we think this was an important topic? Very briefly, Agenda 2030, also known as Sustainable Development Goals, is about leaving no one behind. It's about reaching the furthest behind first. If you look at SDG 10, which is about reducing inequality, that's never been in a global goal before, the first target is progressively achieve and sustain income growth of the bottom 40% of the population at a rate higher than the national average. Pakistan has committed to do that over the next, well, now 13 years or so. In Pakistan, quoting Mahbub al-Haq again, the problem of 22 families controlling 66% of Pakistan's industrial assets remains still relevant today, and there is rising inequality in Pakistan on all measures, whether it's income or what's called multidimensional poverty. But with that, I think I might pass on to Hafiz, who is the leader of a team that UNDP has put together on the National Human Development Report for Pakistan, whose theme is human development and inequality. And he'll give an update of where that work is and frame the discussion, and the other panelists will comment on different topics. Over to you, Hafiz.
Thank you, Neil. Can you hear me? Sorry. Okay. members of the panel, ladies and gentlemen, as always, coming to the literary festival is a source of great joy and hope that we still have those traditions in our country. Let me start by just very quickly quoting from the latest World Inequality Report of 2018. It has a very appropriate sentence. If rising inequality or diminishing equity is not properly monitored and addressed, it can lead to various sorts of political, economic, and social catastrophes. The word catastrophes has been used. And clearly, this will reduce what in the country called Bhutan, there is, we have a unique measure to measure the size of the countries, and that is the gross national happiness. So there's a very strong relationship between equity and happiness, and I'm glad that we'll be focusing on that. Neil, a wonderful colleague of mine, has already highlighted the Sustainable Development Goals of the United Nations up to 2020. There's one particular goal which explicitly addresses the issue of inequality. And this must have required courage on the part of the United Nations, because generally inequality is seen as a very sensitive subject in multilateral fora. However, due credit must be given to the UN for having introduced a target which says progressively achieve and sustain income group of the bottom 40% at a rate higher than the national average. So that is a tremendous step forward. The Millennium Development Goals, which preceded, had nothing on inequality. Ladies and gentlemen, let me give you some idea of the extent of inequality. Neil has already given you an indicator which goes back to the 60s, the famous 22 families. Let me give you some more, also some recent information based on the work that my very strong, wonderful team is doing on inequality. The first, let me highlight to you how the distribution of farm area is in Pakistan. According to the population and agricultural censuses, 1% of the farmers of Pakistan, believe it or not, 1%, 92,000 farmers, own 22% of the farm area of Pakistan. And the bottom 50%, who are about almost 5 million farmers, own only 12% of the farm area. I mean, this is inequality at an extreme. And this is seldom advertised, because clearly land reform and other such issues have died in Pakistan. But we still continue to have a very strong feudal presence. These roughly 100,000 farmers, each has a farm which is about 500 acres in size. Let me just quote one more. And that is the wealth in the form of residential property. That is perhaps one of the most important indicators of wealth, the quality of your residential property. Here, according to the research we have done, the top 20% of the population owns almost 56% of the residential property, while the bottom 20% owns only 5%. The ratio is 11 to 1. This is the extent of inequality we see in this country. Let me give you some very important evidence on poverty based on some excellent work done by UNDP and the Oxford Institute for Human Development and Poverty. And I would like to play a little game with you. I'd like to ask you, where within our broader contours of our country, where do you think the incidence of poverty is the lowest? Do you want to make a guess? Anybody? Where do you think it's the lowest? Punjab? Anybody else? Lowest. Yes. Who said Kashmir? Brilliant. The lowest incidence of poverty is in Azad Jammu and Kashmir of only 24%. And you should be proud that while on the other side of the line of control there is chaos and havoc, in our part there is peace and progress. And I hope that we can highlight this internationally. Somebody mentioned Balochistan. Do you know that the incidence of poverty in Balochistan, multidimensional, is as high as 70%? 70%. And the part which has the highest incidence of poverty in our country is what you have referred to, federally administered tribal areas, FATA. 72% of the people of FATA are poor, based on this very good, high-quality research. Surely, we must begin to understand that one of the root causes of religious extremism and poverty, which has been at its peak, and if you like, root causes of extremism and terrorism, is poverty, extreme poverty. And unless we can sort this problem out, we will continue to be confronted with this problem. Let me just take you through some other findings of our research. And maybe this may sound a bit provocative, but that's the whole idea in this wonderful festival. Our research spread from 1999-2000, the start of this century, up till now, comes to a very unexpected, perhaps even counterintuitive conclusion. What we are seeing is that inequality rose sharply up till 2008, from 2000 to 2007-08. Then it remained more or less constant for 3-4 years. And interestingly, after 2010-11, it has actually fallen in Pakistan. Unexpected, isn't it? There are two important correlations which begin to explain this curve like this. The first is higher growth leads to more inequality, unfortunately. What we have seen was high growth in early 2000s. Then we saw low growth. Low growth, interestingly, 4.5% or so that we have seen in the last 5 years, has reduced inequality. So inclusiveness and sustainability are much more important than just having growth for the sake of growth. the trickle-down effect in the Musharraf era was even less than the growth we saw in the last 7-8 years in a period of democracy with less growth. Let me just conclude, ladies and gentlemen, by saying that one of the basic lessons that we are learning from our work is the extent of disparity in access to resources, opportunities, and so on. And if I may use a strong expression, we have an elite which is prone to state capture. And we would like to highlight what are the mechanisms and instruments that are present in our institutions, in our laws, in our practices, and in the power structure overall, which have led to structural problems of high inequality. So I assure you that over the next 4 to 6 months, we are working very hard to produce an objective and evidence-based inequality report for Pakistan. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hafiz. A brilliant start to the session. And I'd like to invite Anjab Saqib, who spent his life working on these issues, to say a little bit about what he thinks the effects of inequity are on, well, you say people's happiness, you could say people's development. They're not always synonymous with the experience working with so many people who've been left outside. Mr. Saqib.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you very much, Neil. I don't know how to begin. Basically, I'm a practitioner and I can't, you know, go in the academic details. But let me, you know, say in the beginning that poverty is pain and poverty is poison. And this is our joint responsibility to fight poverty. Whether poverty leads to unhappiness or unhappiness is the, you know, forerunner of poverty or vice versa. But the point is that this is a literary, you know, festival, and I am, you know, remembering one of the famous quotes of a literary figure, Ishfaq Ahmed, who used to say that poverty is not only the lack of money. Poverty is lack of friendship, lack of connectivity, lack of relationship. If you allow me to say his actual words in Urdu, he used to say, "Ghurbat daulat se mehroomi ka naam nahi hai, ghurbat asal mein akele reh jane ka naam hai." Bhari duniya mein koi aisa shakhs nahi jiske kandhe pe aap sar rakh sakein, to aap ghareeb hain. So I think in a very literary, in a content, he has described the essence of poverty. And this is the real issue, this exclusion. This political inclusion, social inclusion, financial inclusion. So all these are extremely important if we really want to address poverty. We have been working throughout Pakistan, alhamdulillah, in the four provinces in southern Punjab, and most importantly, we have been working in Fata and in Gilgit-Baltistan and in Azad Jammu Kashmir as well. You know, the whole focus of our, you know, solution to poverty is not giving them education, our health facility, our financial inclusion. We begin by inclusion. We first of all like to connect to the people. We would like to organize people. We would like to bring people at one platform. And we would like to, you know, inculcate a spirit of mutual reciprocity and solidarity. So I think, you know, in isolation, if you are doing educational programs and other social development programs, or you are providing microfinance or financial, other financial, you know, services. But as long as we are, you know, increasing the gulf between haves and have-nots, we will never be able to address the issue of poverty. We will have to think on these issues that how we can bring people together. You know, we were poor, but still we were happy decades ago when our villages were vibrant, when there were no gaps, you know, between poor and rich in a city. They were living in the same vicinity. But now we have different localities, different, you know, streets and different areas for the poor and for the rich. So I think there are multiple reasons for poverty. There are multiple, you know, areas how we can, you know, address this poverty, multiple solutions. But we must think that why this gap is increasing every day, why the rich are becoming richer and why the poor are poor, despite the growth, despite the increase in GDP, despite all this, you know, betterment in the technology and all other areas. We must see the spiritual or the moral dimension as well, that how can we help create a society where everybody is willing to support others, and this willingness will become, I think, the most important ingredient for ultimate solution. If you allow me to give the example of the organization Akhuwat, which literally means solidarity or brotherhood. So we say that through this organization, we have provided financial inclusion to 3 million people, families. But in fact, this is not what we say. We say that we have created a bond of solidarity, love, and compassion with these 3 million people. We don't go to them and say that this is money we have brought to you. We go and say that we are brothers and sisters. We are here to establish a bond of solidarity and love and brotherhood with you. All other things will follow. First of all, we would like to give them this feeling that we are not alone in society. We are part of a larger whole. And not only the state, but the entire civil society is thinking about us. And this will give them reassurance, and this will bring them in the mainstream. And this will, you know, be perfect to help them realize their own potential. So this is my initial statement, that poverty is a multidimensional effect, a multidimensional phenomena. And poverty is not only the lack of money. Poverty is social, it is spiritual, it is moral, it's political. And to address all these dimensions of poverty, we must, you know, create a society where there is not much gap between the haves and have-nots. For example, if 50% of haves in Pakistan embrace 50% of have-nots, just extend their arm and say that we are brothers. One family with one family. One person with one person. So in a larger context, this is also the spirit of mawakhat, which our Prime Minister is also, you know, raising, and he's saying that he will be trying to build the entire Pakistani society on the spirit and the teachings of Mawakhat in Medina. So Mawakhat also gives this message that if there are two sections of society, haves and have-nots, so just by creating this bond of solidarity between one person from haves and one person from have-nots, this is and also food for thought, that would it be a practical or pragmatic way to eliminate poverty.
Thank you very much. I mean, one of the points you made about sort of separation between rich and poor was reinforced when I, nearly 3 years ago, was in Lahore and for a happy occasion, but it coincided with a sad occasion when there was this terrible bombing of this children's park where many children and their parents were killed. And I talked to friends about it, and they said, oh, we used to go there when we were younger ourselves. But that park had become now a place primarily for low-income or lower-middle-class people, and the rich didn't go there anymore. So rather than a place to bring people together, it became rather a place where mainly the children of poorer people were killed. Erem, you've been deeply involved internationally and nationally in Pakistan on issues. She led a key part of a panel yesterday on water issues. And there's a big interface between environmental issues and poverty, but many others, so over to you.
Thanks so much. Okay, what I want to put on the table is differential access, and I'm going to focus very carefully and very precisely on water. It really does matter, and let's see if this gives us something to think about. We have a system, a canal irrigation system that runs throughout this country. The British essentially created this system starting in the 1800s, and there is something called Varabandi. So what it is it's a time allocation of water turn. So you, for your plot of land, supposing you get, you know, it's like turn by turn, right, down a canal system. The idea when they designed the system is that they wanted it to be very equitable. And that's a term that will help us think about something. They wanted it to be equitable because the idea was that therefore everyone would get water that you would need to grow a certain amount, you know, that would sort of help you cultivate your size of plot. And that would be somehow promoting where everybody would have enough and enough food security, etc., would be produced by this Varabandi. What's fascinating is that pretty much from the start of this system, which is really like the core, you know, of how the country sort of, you know, say 20-25% of our GDP is still linked to an agricultural income, right? So it really is the core of the economic base. However you think about it, we have to start thinking about the rural areas. So essentially, it was always supposed to be equitable. But pretty much from day one, what happens with this system is that it is deeply inequitable. What ends up happening is that the more influential who have more access, again, I mean, you mentioned, you know, sort of state capture, who have more access to power, utilize a lot more than their particular turn of water. So if they're supposed to get, you know, water for 6 hours, I mean, maybe they'll take the next one down's line, turn the next one down, the next one down, right? So they are utilizing much more than their actual share. Essentially, the system has never worked largely as intended. So a system even designed to be equitable, where they're really thinking about this in the 1830s, that says, you know, we will like uplift everyone and everyone will have some kind of food security, has not functioned like that. So this differential access, inequitable access to a crucial natural resource such as water is elemental in a semi-arid environment. That really does matter. There is plenty of land, but irrigated land is what is of value. All of the fights are about water. All of the power is linked to whether or not you can get more water than your turn. So this background, and now I'm going to put a small problem. This idea that somehow we can keep everyone at an equal level and then everyone will be okay is, I think, deeply problematic also. Because then it never allows anyone perhaps to figure out, you know, maybe I can use water more efficiently, maybe I can use crops that I can export, etc. So this idea of, I mean, and this is like, this is a vision sort of conflict, right? What sort of society do we want to create? Is it where everyone has enough to eat plus a little surplus and is largely at a similar level? Or do we really want to figure out, is there a way to uplift and a few people get more ahead, etc. Right now, it's sort of through cheating almost, right? And it's using your levers of power and it's utilizing much more than your equitable share, so-called. So even if you design a system as equitable, because of family relations, power relations, marriage relations, biradri, this has always worked in this part of the world. And the British, by the way, knew this. And they basically pretty much gave up on this idea that we were ever going to be able to run this equitably. It has never run equitably. So this is a major challenge in a sort of hydrologically dry environment. So I want to put this idea of, you know, equity and the lack of it in a natural resource, but it's really a fundamental construct of this country. And so for me, I want us to start really thinking very hard about this access to natural resources, whether it's water, in my case, I mean, that's what I study, I sort of obsess about it, but I think it really does matter. But of course, there are many, many, many other things. If I could, so I just finished teaching environmental law, and one of the things that all of you here in Lahore sitting are aware of is air quality, right? So this idea of we all breathe the same air, right? So how do you even, you know, sort of have like sort of pockets of air where it's clean air or not? So we have to start thinking of natural resources and what is it that we all share equally, and what is it that we can somehow utilize our levers of power and utilize more than our due turn or our due share. So I just wanted to sort of help problematize some of this history that structures this country.
The interesting proposition that programs that are actually designed in the name of equity end up becoming the most inequitable. So it may be better to be more honest in terms of the design and deal and help prevent what actually ends up becoming a source of unhappiness as well as inequity. Now, Taimur Jagra is in the hot seat right now as he's the finance minister of KPK, and he's taken on that job coming from things where he could have been doing something else, I think, which is to be very much respected. And he has to deal with actually practical policies to deal with these issues. So I'm going to give the floor to him. And then after that, we'll go to a discussion.
Thank you so much. I think incredibly interesting debate. I think when you practically come down to it, it's important to state, I think a little bit as Iram said, the choices are hard. They're incredibly hard. It's easy to talk about equality. I prefer other words, but let me illustrate. Make the choice for yourself. Was the more equal China of the late 70s a better place where everyone was equally poor? Or is the China of today, or even 10 years ago, I lived in China between 2003 and 2005. And the emerging levels of inequality were clear. And yes, they bring problems and lots of deep problems. But also the fact that they were pulling hundreds of millions of people out of poverty, also clear. So I guess the challenge is, as in many things, that you've got to find a balance. Very clearly, and I think the word, Aram, you were looking for when you said everyone being equal is communism, and yes, there's people who can still ascribe to that as a philosophy or as an endpoint, but very clearly there is the counter view of saying, if I'm going to create wealth, it's going to find its way disproportionately, and if I have a choice of trying to stifle wealth creation and spread it across, or try to go for the goal of try to give everyone a minimum living standard, what do I do and how do I prevent the balance going too far one way or the other? I think that's the real practical challenge. We face that every day. On top of that, we face that with constraints of capacity on the resources that we have. And that takes me to the second point. We can sit and talk about it until the cows come home, but it's really about action. I think we have some incredibly talented people in this country, as we do in many other countries. I think we have some incredibly smart people, incredibly noble people. But the ones that I respect the most are the ones that actually roll their sleeves up and do something about it. I've met Dr. Amjad Saqib 5 or 6 years ago, and what I respect, and I'm not saying this to your face, is not necessarily the smartness, but the humility and the drive for action. Someone may be making a difference to 100 people, someone to 1,000 people, someone to 100,000 people, but that's what's going to make the difference. And practically, the issues that we see, if they were issues of policy or smarter policy, we would have gone way further ahead than we have. If you look at the different components of inequity, whether that's education, right? Again, you have this issue of trying to give everyone a uniform standard of education, or if you actually want everyone to learn in their best learning environment. I've worked in education for about a decade. That system needs to be much more bespoke, and if it needs to be bespoke, it actually needs to cater to people's mother tongue, it needs to cater to people's background, and therefore, by definition, if you want people learning the most, they need to learn in slightly different environments, right? The same if you're talking about health. So when I was working as a consultant at McKinsey or now working in government, what frustrates me the most is people who will talk of the policy required to create change but not be willing to take half a step, let that be an imperfect step, towards actually translating some of that into action. So I think that's where the debate or the spotlight, I think the word debate in itself is part of the problem, that's where the spotlight needs to be. And so I think the third thing, as Dr. Hafiz Pasha said, I think these sessions, if they have to have value, have to be about being a little bit provocative, is about redefining equity or our goals on this front a little bit, right? There is definitely the social dimension. I think I'm just going to take a couple of lens at this. One is to throw two or three words, which I think are better barometers of what we're trying to achieve. One is, and I'm going to steal these words from what everyone has said, one is about greater meritocracy, because that creates opportunity. And I think part of the dissatisfaction of inequality in societies has to be driven about dissatisfaction about opportunity or the sense of injustice that people feel. And hence, the need for meritocracy in society is important, because if I don't have a chance, then I've got no sense to be optimistic or happy at all. And hence, the second one is opportunity. Whatever we can do, and what the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa government is trying to go big on, I think the entire national government is this element of, you know, giving people a chance by giving them an opportunity, giving them a little bit of capital, the sort of interest-free microfinance that Amjad Saqib Saab and other organizations are working on, because we've got to give people the opportunity to live ahead, and that's one question that is constantly ticking in our mind. I think a third thing, and one we certainly lack as a nation, I'll put my hand up and say the first thing. This is where the Prime Minister tends to inspire me sometimes. The third word is empathy. If the haves don't have empathy for the have-nots, you know, it's interesting that to create this culture of, and it may even be symbolic, of having shelter homes for the homeless, it actually needs in our society the Prime Minister to raise his voice when there's plenty of property, plenty of opportunity to do this. So it makes me think, in a way, there's so many of us that even perhaps may be working on reducing inequity, that may be on some dimensions morally dead, or certainly can do better on this dimension of empathy. But lastly, there's the other elements of inequality. Remember that we are a federation. I'm very grateful that Dr. Hafiz Pasha mentioned FATA. I can certainly tell you that in terms of, look, if you cut society different ways, if you cut it by ethnicity, if you cut it by sex, if you cut it by the urban-rural divide, I think this is where people in one part of the country or in one of these divides look at another part and say, this is unfair, this is unequal. To me, the biggest example, and again, I've traveled to Lahore every week between 2011 and 2017 working on education reform in my previous career. But it did strike me in the bad old days of greater militancy that when this country was suffering from, that whenever that militancy hit close to home, mainstream Pakistan, let's say Lahore, Karachi, Islamabad, our reaction and our concern was very different than when it hit the 5 million people of Fatah. And actually, when you think of it, those 5 million people we've ignored for about 70 years, ignored of being equal citizens. And that's not the only pocket in the country. So does it really surprise us, right, that pockets of society within places like Fatah and Balochistan raise their hands and say, there's something seriously wrong or inequitable in the way that we're being dealt? And I also question whether that's just, that's the last thing that I'll say, whether that's just economic opportunity or investing economic resources. It certainly is. It's a massive part of the problem. Or whether it's also political opportunity in terms of giving people the sense that they've got equal rights and are equal citizens. And that, I think, in terms of reducing inequality and increasing happiness, is probably, in my opinion, not just the biggest challenge for the government of Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, but also for the entire country, to include these elements that have been excluded from the mainstream of the country.
Thank you, Taimur. That reminded me that in the last National Human Development Report, there was an annex which broke down human development levels by district in Pakistan. And where we're sitting in Lahore, and where I live in Islamabad, was sort of equivalent to Spain or Italy, the northern parts, the wealthier parts. And where I travel often in Fatah, or in Balochistan, or in Tarparka, the levels are similar to the worst levels in sub-Saharan Africa, or even worse. That shows that I think the geographic divisions in the country. With that, we have about 15, 20 minutes or so for some questions, discussion. So over to you in the audience. I see a gentleman in the first row there, and then I think there's some mics moving around somewhere. Yeah, I think there's a woman coming down with a mic for you, sir.
My name is Margoob Ahmed. My question is addressed to Dr. Hafiz Pasha, and I think who is having very key understanding of the issues at the local level. The thing is that, Dr. Saab, practically speaking, and I'm referring to the historical angle too, we have a country where three parts of the economy go to one pillar. Indirectly, I'm referring to an institution, army. And historically, this is a country where even democracy has not been flourished in the true sense of the word. Even not to talk about the word, where there had been never 15 true democracy in the world. We are having probably 200 nations in the globe, but not 15 true democracy in the world. My question is that, what is the current status of our parliament? Constitution and law of this country say supremacy of parliament, actually, indeed. When one pillar is checking out internal and foreign policy of this land, who is thinking?
Just, I have a little limit on myself to questions to like 1.5 minutes. And
yes,
you're coming up to that. Do you have I think you've made your question. Do you have a supplement?
Very specifically, that who is going to check out human development, equity, and happiness policies if one pillar is constitutionally dominating over others?
Thank you. Maybe I'll take a couple questions.
Sure.
One more question, and then maybe we'll go. I see in the back a woman up in the orange. Yeah.
Uh, Assalamu alaikum. My question is to the entire panel that you've been talking about how equity is important, and but also that, you know, communism isn't an ideal situation, because those were some of the examples given. But I see in Pakistan specifically, but also around the world, that labor is undervalued a lot. And what specifically should be done to produce equity in that sense? Because yes, there is development, and yes, companies are progressing, and there is economic development of specific countries. But the lowest workers in those companies are paid very little. Like recently we did, we had a survey, household survey, and there was a woman working for a factory who was just getting paid 6,000 rupees per month just for cleaning the factory. So even if the CEO is earning a lot, what can be done to convince those companies to pay their laborers a fair amount?
Okay, thank you. So, and then the second question, other people can try to address. Yeah.
I think you've asked a very important question, and I think it's very important that I give you what I believe is a fair response. I had already highlighted to you that we have a very interesting relationship. During periods of high growth, we have seen much more dramatic increases in inequality. And a reason primarily for that is that the benefits of the growth don't trickle down to the lowest sections of society. Most of the additional resources get preempted by the power structure, the elite, and so on. The other very interesting relationship is that we have generally tended to have high periods of growth, high growth, during military regimes. And the three examples of that are the Ayyub regime, the Ziaul-Haq regime, and of course the most recent one, which is the Musharraf era. Somehow or the other, it seems to me that because there are factors which contribute to a larger inflow of resources during those periods, due to certain adventures, if I may use the word, somehow or the other, I mean, this is something we are working on, and I speak with all honesty. It seems to me that in a search for legitimacy, military governments tend to establish a social contract with the more powerful and the elite. However imperfect our democracies have been, somehow or the other, I have a sense that we have had more of the voice of the people. I'll give you one small example and then I'll conclude. During the period when economic conditions were looking much better, in the Musharraf period, there was little or no emphasis on social protection. The protection that we have seen come up in 2008 onwards, with the emergence of programs like the Benazir Income Support Program, like the microcredit program, the Poverty Alleviation Fund program, the Akuwat program, and so on. This has all flourished in a way, in a sense, when people have had a greater sense of participation. So in my own sense, we need to work more for strengthening the institutions of democracy.
So would one of the panelists like to address the second question? The timer, yeah.
Look, I can start off addressing that. I just want to also build on what Dr. Hafiz Pasha said. I think there's two elements to what you asked. As the politician in the room, I think it's probably right that, you know, if I stay quiet, then it reinforces what you're saying. We're not worth anything. Look, what you said basically points to two things. A, that the army takes too much of the pie, and B, that we, the political leadership, aren't empowered to do enough. I think something that Dr. Hafiz Pasha said I think is incredibly true. And I'm reminded of it multiple times during the day, which is, indeed, democracies, however imperfect, have to be more considerate of the populace and in particular of the poor, because we're reminded of it every day. Just come and spend a day shadowing me outside my office and you will see. Absolutely. When you've got poor people knocking at your door, they don't let you forget it. I go and I meet ordinary people, or I meet even rich people, and I say, how's the gas, how's the electricity, how's the water? Because that's what people are knocking at me and saying, we've got these issues. So I think that is an incredibly important facet of democracy, and I think the good news is that our imperfect democracy has continued in some form or the other since 2002, so almost 20 years, and it starts to institutionalize. I think this government is at least thinking we're going to spend 5 years over here. The two things in terms of what you said is, look, we're going to have a greater leadership role the greater we perform. It's not going to happen by raising our hands, it's going to happen by what we do. And that's going to take time, and I'm optimistic that that's something that's progressively going to happen. As to the amount of money that we can put into poverty, and I'm sure others will bear me out on this, we have defense needs, but we have other needs. We don't have enough to fulfill any of what we have. We both need to make choices, but we also need to increase the size of the pie at 12% tax to GDP. We're not going to have enough to spend to address any needs that we... So I think we're going to need to take the bull by the horns as a society, not just as government, and say this country needs to generate more. As to the labor question, I agree. I think it's partially enforcement. I think the challenge is we have mechanisms. We have the Workers' Welfare Fund. We have a bunch of other things through which, you know, money's supposed to go to labor that's supposed to regulate or take care of the rights of poor labor. But somehow, so many of our institutions erode over time. They don't do their job. They become dens of corruption. And so you create institutions for a certain purpose, and they pivot and go in the opposite direction. I think the answer to an extent is A, greater enforcement, B, strengthening the institutions that are supposed to enforce, but C, in some cases, and again I'm going to be provocative, applying common sense. It does depend. We ought to have a minimum wage law. We ought to revise that. But there are, again, challenges. For me, the classic case is teachers in low-cost private schools. They also get paid, typically, say, between 6 and 10,000, which is below the minimum wage. You can increase... Unfortunately, that's the price point at which the market works. Allows those schools to price education at 500 rupees a month for kids in a space that government is unable to provide because we don't have enough resources. You can pay them all the minimum wage, but the fee structure will go to a point where you'll get another 20% of kids out of school. If you choose to now treat the jobs that these teachers are doing as part-time jobs or as secondary income, it may still not be a perfect world, but you're increasing household income, you're solving an education issue. So I think one of the answers to each of the questions like that you ask, or one of the elements also has to be to apply common sense so that we apply it in the right place. And in trying to solve a harm, we don't do more harm than originally intended.
Neil, can I just jump in there just on this? I really want to take up your question. I think you have a great question. And again, because we're all being provocative, I think the problems with the garment industry are massive. The issue of piecework is huge. Essentially, when something like the Baldia factory fire happens, when the Rana Plaza factory fire happens, I mean, an immense number of people die, and we can't even trace the companies that source. So there's a lot of work that people are trying to link the value chain and trying to figure out, well, where is the different work, you know, who's sewing the buttons on and what's getting exported. But really, I want to also put on this idea of empathy, which was here. The I think the essential problem is until people in, say, where people have affordability, right, where they can access resources, until and unless people at that point of buying are really looking for that $10 T-shirt, essentially, they're not at that point conscious of, well, what is the person who's producing getting, right? So it really, in a world of global markets, there is responsibility across the developing world, the developed world, and obviously those are individual person, you know, sort of purchasing decisions. We've put so much sort of purchasing power in people's hands. So it's a very complex problem. And given the complexity of like the global capitalistic system, these ideas of, well, what can any one country do, right, to actually enforce, and where will people be cutting corners, and where will, you know, there not be fire alarms and all kinds of things, right, it becomes more complex. So I think there's many, many things that we need to work on, and maybe sort of just working on just like human empathy, right, when you are buying that $10 T-shirt is something where people are conscious of what is it that they're doing and the effects that their actions are having on people they will never meet halfway around the world, right? That consciousness of how do we live and who are we as human beings. So thanks for your question.
I think we have time for maybe one question, maybe two. I'll go to the gentleman on the right and then the lady in the left in the yellow. Yeah. But just give you make your questions very pointed because we really have about three, four minutes.
Can we really address inequality when the living wage is more than the minimum wage? And is part of the problem that the representatives of the masses are not part of the masses, they're part of the elite, and many of them, you see, are actually industrialists. So is it in their interest to actually have a minimum wage which is more than the living wage, or at least equal to it?
All right, and then...
My question is to Dr. Saab, Dr. Hafeez Pasha. I was wondering what is wrong with going the way China did. First, have equity. And once you reach a threshold, then open up to capitalism or capitalistic structure like they did. What is wrong with going that way?
First, a question on minimum wage. Who would like to forget?
I think... about the relationship between the living wage and the minimum wage. You see, to me, the living wage corresponds to what one would consider as the cost of meeting basic human needs. In some sense, equivalent to, say, the poverty line. And you're absolutely right. In Pakistan today, the poverty line is about 3,500 rupees per capita. And the typical family size in Pakistan is about 6. And therefore, the minimum living wage in that sense, if there's one worker in the family, is 21,000 rupees. And unfortunately, our minimum wage varies a bit from area to area and province to province, is hardly 15,000 rupees. But the more worrying statistic, which has been referred to by Aram and in the question, only 32% of the workers of Pakistan, even in the organized sector, get the minimum wage. That is the extent of exploitation. And with all due respects, again, the tragedy is that the collective bargaining system was destroyed by the military governments. First, Ziaul-Haq regime. And you'll be amazed, countries like Turkey have 60 to 70% membership of trade unions. In our case, not even 1%. How can you give a sense of, if you like, some degree of ability or power to strike for your basic rights as a worker? So we need to now think in terms of some strengthening of the collective bargaining, and the Constitution explicitly provides for that.
Thank you. On the China question, I suggest Hafiz may correspond with you directly on that, because that's a complicated question.
You want?
No, I think the time is up. Okay. I've just been told that because we have to go get ready for the next presentation. But no, I think we can have a chat afterwards. Yesterday, there was a similar situation. There was a great session on population and populism and the future of democracy. And it ran out of time at the end. But one of the things that was highlighted was the danger of people being left out for too long a period, and how that can rise to people who think that there are simple answers to it, and how that's exploited, and how that leads to instability. And I think the issue in Pakistan is that, as has been said, there is progress, but the level of exclusion is still so high. And how do you accelerate that? And there's some good examples here, Mr. Sattar. There's good examples from government, from academia abroad as well. But lots more to do. So look for the global, for the National Human Development Report, which will come out in about 6 months.
Yes.
And we'll have all the answers for you in that. Okay.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Well done.
Thank you very much. Thank you.